Welcome into another episode of Tailscale Explained. I'm Alex. In this series, we cover everything you ever wanted to know about Tailscale, things like subnet routers or Tailscale SSH. And today we're going to cover ACLs. You can find a link to the Tailscale Explained playlist in the description down below. Now you can think of ACLs or access control lists as a series of rules or permissions that govern how and where data can flow within your tailnet. If you've ever worked with a firewall rule in the past, you'll feel pretty comfortable with the concept right away. By default, your tailnet ships with a permissive allow all rule, which allows every node to talk to every other node within your tailnet. That's because architecturally, a tailnet is designed around the concept of least privilege. In other words, unless you explicitly allow something to happen, it can't. One of the most common questions we hear is, how does Tailscale's mesh architecture differ from a traditional VPN using a hub and spoke model? Well, ACLs are a culmination of one of those mesh architecture benefits. By connecting each node directly to your tailnet, you gain fine-grained control over the connectivity between those nodes and a whole host of other benefits like end-to-end encryption as well. And this is all done without relying on a potentially bottlenecked centralized VPN server too. Nearly every connection with Tailscale is a direct device-to-device connection. ACLs can govern anything from SSH connections to controlling traffic based on source device, destination device, protocol, port number, and a whole bunch more stuff. There'll be a link to the documentation for ACLs down below where the full feature set is discussed for you. In today's video though, I'm going to show you how to write your first ACL rule with a feature that not many people know exists. Tests, built right into your ACL rule set. By writing a test, we can ensure that your ACLs are doing exactly what you expect them to do at all times. So let's jump into writing your first rule. You can find your ACLs under the Access Controls option in your Tailscale admin console. Now this is a demo tailnet that I have here, and you can see I've got a bunch of pre-configured ACL rules in here already. Now a quick tip before we get started, if you want to go back to factory defaults and get back to our default policy file, simply clear out the entire contents of this text box and click on this Reset to Default Policy button down here at the bottom. If it turns out that that was a mistake for you and you think to yourself, I wish I hadn't made that change for whatever reason, you can go up to the logs option here again in the Tailscale admin console and look at the audit log for the various changes that were made to the configuration of your tailnet. You can see that in these configuration logs, I have an option here to look at the changes that were made, a bit like a git diff between the left and the right side, a few moments ago. So now if I want to revert my changes and go back to my previous version, I simply scroll down to the revert to previous version button, click on revert, and then if I go back to my access controls page, you can see that my ACLs file is now back as it was a few moments ago. Now just so that we're all starting from the same place, I'm going to reset my policy file back to scratch again, back to factory, the default policy. And you'll notice that there are a few things going on in this file. Firstly, I want to talk you through the fact that this is something called HUJSON, human readable JSON. And this editor has a bunch of syntax checking built in for you. So if we forget, for example, to close a bracket, I'm just going to comment this out with a pair of forward slashes. If we make a mistake, this editor will kind of sanity check a lot of stuff for us. This is how all the test validation stuff works later too, which we'll get onto. Don't worry about that. So you can just go through and make edits in here, and it's a fairly intelligent editor, even though it looks like it's just a text box. It's got some smarts behind it. So the first rule I want to draw your attention to, the first block, I suppose, is this ACLs block here. This is that permissive allow all rule that I mentioned in the intro. This is the rule that allows us to connect any device to any device. And indeed, we can verify that with a very simple SSH script. So if I show you this script I have here, which is it's super basic, to be honest, but it does a connect timeout every second and tries to SSH into one of my tailnet nodes called fake NAS. So if I just leave this running in the background, you'll see that right now I'm connected to that node. If I just pop this up here in the corner, we'll leave that running up there. Now, as soon as I make a change to my rule set, I want you to watch in real time what happens. Really, I'm going to click save. And within a split second, you can see that the SSH connections have stopped working. That's because in real time, these changes get pushed down to each device. each tailnet policy file gets sent to the local device. These rule sets are enforced locally. They're not enforced by the centralized server. So they're very performant. And I want to just show you the fact that it works in real time in the other way as well. If I re-enable that rule, you'll see that as soon as the tailnet policy file gets saved, the SSH connections are re-established almost right away. So having such a wide open permissive rule can potentially be a little bit of a security risk, right? We don't necessarily want our developers to be able to SSH into production. So I can't imagine why you might want to not allow your developers to SSH into production. But anyway, sometimes that is the world that we live in. So how can we go about writing a rule that would let, for example, only my laptop here connect to that other host over SSH? It's actually quite straightforward. All we do, I'm just going to copy and paste something here in from my notes, is we write a rule that says the action here is to accept a connection or allow traffic, in other words, from a source called Magrathea, which actually should be MBP Baldrick, I think, in this case. And this is going to fail, don't worry. This is all part of the act. With the destination, in this case, of fake NAS with a wildcard for the port number on the protocol of TCP. You can change this to be UDP. There's a bunch of other stuff too. So if we look in the syntax reference here in the documentation, you can see that the protocol option supports any IANA protocol number from 1 through to 255. So jumping back to our ACLs file, I'm just going to leave this as TCP because that's the protocol SSH transits over. It's a TCP protocol. I'm going to disable this allow all rule. So we've already seen that as soon as I do that, all of the SSH connections are actually going to stop for us. So if I click save, we can see that we've got a problem immediately. The source MBP Baldrick is an invalid address. Now at first, that might seem a little weird because if we look at my tailnet configuration up here, this device, MBP Baldrick, well, it exists. And this is a deliberate choice that we've made, architecturally speaking, because we don't want to allow people to change their node names. I mean, typically in these ACL files, you can refer to nodes by their host names. Whereas in this specific case, you actually have to define explicitly the hosts that are listed. So I'm going to copy in another small piece of code just here for us. And you can see that I've got a list of hosts, but I don't have MBP Baldrick. So let's go ahead and add that. So MBP Baldrick, and then I need to get my IP address, the number here, the 100. I can go in macOS client anyway. I can go up to the menu bar, click on the this device option, and then just put this into my ACLs file over here. And now what we've got is essentially we've set a hosts variable. And this is done deliberately so that people can't rename their nodes and gain permission to resources simply by virtue of their node name matching something in the ACL rule set that it shouldn't. So you have to explicitly allow MBP Baldrick to be referred to as MBP Baldrick throughout the file. And so we can see that that now is working just fine. The SSH connection remains intact. I'm still making my connection every second over here. But let's say I wanted to just change this port number from a wildcard, which allows every TCP port, to only allowing a TLS port on port 443. If I click save, we'll see that immediately the SSH connection on port 22 starts complaining. That's exactly what we would expect. So again, if I change this to 22, we'll see that again in real time, the SSH connection comes back again. And so that's the general principle behind writing your first ACL rule. We have an action, which in this case is accept. Deny, by the way, is not a valid option to put into this block. And that's because, remember, Tailscale works on a least privilege model. So everything by implicit design is deny. So the only permissible value in action is accept. Source, well, that should be fairly self-explanatory. That's the source, the origin of where the traffic is coming from. Destination is where the traffic is going to. So in our case, fake NAS and then port 22, although we had a wildcard at the beginning. And then the protocol is TCP, as I mentioned. So let's just presuppose we've spent several hours working and making our tailnet policy file perfect, or we want to make sure that we're writing the correct rules that do the right things for us. We're going to need to start looking at tests, which I mentioned again in the intro. So let's just put in a rule here. I'm going to bring something in from my clipboard again. You can see at the bottom, there is a test section commented out. I'm going to replace this with the thing from my clipboard and also just modify this to say MBP Baldrick. And you can see that I've now got a test in place, which is going to enforce and assert that I can SSH to fake NAS on port 22. So if I now try and change in my ACL rule further up here on the top, if I now try and change that to 443, you can see I can't. That's because the test has failed. So I'd need to modify my test as well. And now you can see I can save the ACL rule. And obviously notice that the SSH traffic has dropped over here on the right-hand side too. And so that's the general idea behind tests. If you try and modify the file such that it breaks the test assertion, you can't do it. This can be particularly useful whilst modifying things much further up in the file without realizing that you're actually breaking connectivity that perhaps your CI server needs to make sure that it can actually connect from where it is into production to deploy for you or something. It's very easily done, and these tests prevent those mistakes from happening. Tailscale SSH is one of my favorite Tailscale features. In fact, we have a whole separate Tailscale Explained video about the specifics of it. But in a nutshell, it runs a second SSH server as part of the Tailscale daemon and intercepts incoming SSH requests on the Tailscale interface. It reuses the identity you implicitly provide by being connected to your tailnet to validate against the parameters we set in our ACLs. Those parameters allow or deny access via SSH. There are no SSH keys to manage. I just love that feature so much. And it's all handled transparently via Tailscale's identity and authentication. Now, in this ACL stanza we're about to cover, we're going to delve a little bit into groups, tags, and node ownership. All of the nodes in this example tailnet are currently owned by the user that authenticated them, and that's me. And we can verify who owns the machine by looking under its node name for this thing here. So this is atailandscales@gmail.com currently owns this node. By default, we ship an ACL rule which allows all users to SSH into their own devices in check mode. So let's just take a quick look at that. Head back over to your access controls page, and in the default policy file, scroll down to the SSH stanza over here. And you'll notice that the action here is check. This check mode requires you to re-authenticate your client as per this check period. The default value for this is every 12 hours. So in other words, if you want to SSH to a specific node and validate someone's identity a little more strongly than just being logged into the tailnet, you can have them re-authenticate to their tailnet in order for the SSH connection to be allowed. Now, if that's a little too much for you, in my home lab at least, I don't need that level of control. You can change this value to accept. And this will simply allow you to connect via SSH to these remote nodes by virtue of being connected to the tailnet. That will be enough identity for you to proceed. You'll notice here that in this stanza, we're using this special group called autogroup. This group automatically includes users and destinations or usernames with the appropriate properties. There's a big long list of autogroups available in the documentation if you want to make use of them, and they can be really handy. One thing I want to point you to, though, is this users line here for SSH. At the moment, I'm allowed to SSH into this node as any user, both root and a non-root user. But if I wanted to, for example, limit SSH access as root, I want to take that permission away from somebody, I now click save. This is going to prevent me from SSHing to fake NAS as root, presuming that the node itself actually allows SSH via root in its SSH configuration. However, as you start to add lots of nodes and more likely lots of users, it can be handy to have a way to allow only certain users to have SSH access to certain nodes, or even not at all. We can do this in a number of ways using the policy file, but the easiest way to group lots of users together are groups. So let's create a couple of groups. So first, let's create two groups. Scroll up to the top of your ACLs file and replace the group stanza with something that looks a little bit like this. You can find all of the syntax in the syntax reference in our documentation over here. This can be really useful when creating automation that connects using SSH on the back end, like a GitHub action or some other CI/CD workflow. But it's also probably just good practice to have users group to affect their worldviews as a unit. Now you can see here in the policy file, I've declared two groups, the admin group and the dev group. And once declared, we can now use those groups in the policy to say that dev can SSH to nodes tagged as dev, for example. But in order for that to work, you're going to have to create a tag owner as well. As the name suggests, ownership of a node is owned by the tag and not a person anymore. Remember how, if I just click save here and go back to my machines page, remember how nodes are owned by the person that authenticated it to the tailnet? Well, if we tag a node, it becomes owned by that tag. So let's create a tag owner. In this case, I'm just going to paste in a few tags I made earlier. And we can see that I've got the prod tag, the CI tag, dev, as well as container. Now, if I click save, what I can do is I can go back to my admin console and I can now apply a tag to a specific node. So let's treat Magrathea, for example, for a second as a developer machine. I can now tag that as dev and we can start to use our policy file to construct elaborate ways of preventing people from accessing certain things that they're not supposed to access or don't need to access. Your security teams are going to love this one. Note that the only way to fully untag a node completely and revert to a person owning a node is to delete the node from your tailnet and re-authenticate it. So, with all of that prep out of the way, let's now start to look at the SSH stanza that we were looking at earlier in our access controls. So scrolling to the bottom, that's where the SSH block typically lives. I'm going to leave the default role in place because this is, in reality, it's just a demo tailnet for me that I can contrive examples for these videos for. But I'm going to add this second rule, which would show the hypothetical conclusion of everything we just discussed. This rule allows users in the dev group to SSH into nodes tagged as dev as a non-root user or the root user via SSH. You can start to get really fancy and lock these things down by explicitly naming source and destination hosts, specific users. For example, let's say I don't want my developers to be able to access all non-root users. I only want them, for example, to be able to access the deploy user via SSH. If I click save now, you'll see that the Tailnet policy file saves correctly. Now, if I was on a node tagged as dev and I was trying to SSH into a remote node tagged as dev, I wouldn't be able to do it for any other user except the user deploy on the remote Linux system. This entire video has really only scratched the surface of what ACLs can do. It's quite a big topic and we didn't even get into stuff like doing it via GitOps. GitOps would let you define your rule sets in code and deploy them automatically using a CI server. This will allow you to follow your organization's typical code review process on network infrastructure changes. So let us know down below if that's a video you would like to see, and I'll make it for you. If you're interested in using Tailscale at your company, reach out to our sales team to get started at tailscale.com/contact/sales. There'll be a link down below for that too. Thank you so much for watching. Happy rule set making. And until next time, I'm Alex from Tailscale.